It's been said that physics is the king of all the science fields. That was certainly true in the 20th century with the birth of modern physics that brought us modern tech we use today, along with the new understanding of our world and our place in it. But it also challenged age-old beliefs we held so dear about our universe. Sometimes, to the layperson, some of the predictions of modern physics, and especially particle physics, might seem out of touch with reality. But today, we will visualize and try to grab some hard concepts of particle physics, starting with quarks and Planck units.
Planck mass is a numerical number in the units of mass that naturally emerges by a particular combination of Planck's constant, the gravitational constant, speed of light. You put them together in the right configuration and you get something with the units of a mass, and the particular amount of mass is about 10 to the 19 times the mass of the proton. 10 to the 19. That's huge, right? So the fundamental mass scale that seems to emerge from our description of the forces of nature and quantum mechanics, speed of light, gravity, and so forth, that number is 10 billion billion times larger than the scale of masses that we actually see in the particles in the world around us. So the question is, why is there such a broad spread of scales? And we've been trying to come to grips with that problem for a very long time. The idea of supersymmetry, this idea that for every known particle, there's a partner particle whose quantum mechanical spin would be different in slightly technical language. That idea was partly introduced to deal with this hierarchy problem. The quality of those partner particles within the theoretical framework allows for a very natural explanation for why the particles would have such a low mass. It all comes down to a symmetry principle. Whenever a number is really small, a natural explanation is, well, it must be small because some kind of symmetry keeps it small. I mean, zero is the most symmetric number we know. You multiply it by anything, you divide it by anything, it stays the same. Symmetry is a quality of a system that is unchanged under a whole variety of transformations. Right, you take a sphere, you rotate it. If it's a nice silver sphere without anything printed on the surface, no matter what angle you look at that sphere, no matter how you twist it and turn it, the sphere looks the same. It is highly symmetric. Similarly, the number zero is highly symmetric. As I said, you multiply, divide, doesn't change. So if you can find a symmetry that naturally yields zero mass for the particles, then you say to yourself, well, maybe that's why they're so small, and maybe that symmetry is not exact. Maybe that symmetry is almost but not quite an exact quality of the world, the environment. And that would allow the masses to be near zero, but not exactly zero. And this is this approach that supersymmetry gives us. So the problem, of course, is no one's found the supersymmetric particles. Large Hadron Collider, the hope was that it would find all sorts of other particles that we hadn't previously seen. Partners of the electron called the supersymmetric electron or the selectron. Partners of the quarks. Squarks would be the supersymmetric partners of the quarks. So it sounds a little silly, but this is a real mathematical theory. And look, a $10 billion machine was built in part to try to find these supersymmetric particles.
Supersymmetry is a space-time symmetry between two basic classes of particles. Supersymmetry predicts that each of the particles in the standard model has a partner with the spin that differs by half of a unit. So bosons are accompanied by fermions and vice versa. Scientists predict the lightest supersymmetric particle to be stable and electrically neutral and to interact weakly with the particles of the standard model. These are exactly the characteristics required for dark matter, thought to make up most of the matter in the universe and to hold galaxies together. The standard model alone does not provide an explanation for dark matter, but supersymmetry is a framework that builds upon the standard model's strong foundation to create a more comprehensive picture of our world. Perhaps the reason we still have some of these questions about the inner workings of the universe is because we have so far only seen half of the picture. Particle accelerators have given us an incredible amount of insight into the world around us. They allow researchers to speed up particles to nearly the speed of light, and then smash them into one another. The resultant explosions and separations of particles help scientists see how particles interact and give us some idea of what the very first moments after the Big Bang could have looked like. Exploring the inner workings of the universe further in a more detailed picture requires to understand the scale of the very small. And the most basic building blocks of the universe are quarks. They are subatomic particles that make up every proton and neutron in existence. They come up in 6 different varieties, which are up, down, top, bottom, strange, and charm. Quarks came into existence since the very first instance of the universe, less than 1 terasecond after the Big Bang. All commonly observable matter in the universe is composed of up quarks, down quarks, and electrons. Quarks have various intrinsic properties, including electric charge, mass, color charge, and spin. They are the only elementary particles in the standard model of particle physics to experience all 4 fundamental interactions. Up and down quarks have the lowest masses of all quarks. The heaviest quark is the top quark, which is about 100,000 times more massive than the 2 lightest types, up and down. The explanation for this hierarchy is still a deep mystery, but there are even stranger and unexplained phenomena surrounding quarks.
The observations seem to suggest that when quarks are in the vicinity of one another, when they're very close, the strong nuclear force, that's what holds protons together, the strong nuclear force gets very weak when the particles are very near each other, and it goes stronger and stronger as you move them apart. Like, that's unusual, right? I mean, if you talk about the gravitational force is very, very strong when things are close, and it gets weak as you move them apart, quite the opposite. And what they showed was that when you take certain quantum mechanical effects into account, it's as if the roiling, bubbly vacuum of space has the property that it kind of anti-screens the force, right? Normally, if you have bubbly things happening, they can intervene in the force between 2 objects and make the force between them weaker. But the bubbly stuff, it turns out, makes the force stronger. And there's that as you move quarks closer and closer together, the force gets weaker and weaker. As you move them apart, it gets stronger and stronger. And this also gives an explanation of why one would never see a quark on its own. First, if you have 2 quarks and you try to pull them apart, the energy of the strong connection between them from the strong nuclear force, it gets stronger and stronger, more and more tension, more and more energy in there. At some point, the energy in the strong connection between them can be transmuted into the production of mass, namely 2 other quarks, a quark and an antiquark. So the connection between them can snap, but when it snaps, you'll find 2 more quarks. So you have 2 quarks. That's the strong force holding them together. More and more tension between them. At some point, the energy and the tension is so strong that it will snap, creating a quark-antiquark pair. So you can't get the quark in isolation. Again, those can snap again. Every time you try to pull a quark by itself, you wind up failing, because as you try to pull them apart, the energy ultimately gets transmuted into the production of a new partner quark. This also explains another issue, which is, you know, when you talk about a proton, if you go to a book and you look up the mass of the quarks that make up a proton, right, the up, the down quark, you look up their masses, if you add them together, basically 3 quarks inside of a proton, the answer you get is a tiny fraction of the mass of a proton itself. So what gives, right? We normally think of, you know, a proton made of 3 quarks, add up the masses of the quarks, you get the mass of the proton, but no, you get a tiny fraction of the mass of the proton. And again, the ideas that we're talking about give an explanation for that, because again, the gluons of the strong interaction that hold the quarks together, they have energy. And indeed, if we show up, there's a proton. Inside the proton, there go the quarks, but the quarks are held together by these energetic tubes of glue, the gluons, and they're in a sea of roiling production of quarks, antiquarks, and gluons all over the place. And it's the energy and all the other stuff that via Einstein's M equals E over C squared contributes the M, the mass of the proton. So most of the mass of the proton is not the intrinsic mass of the quarks. Most of the mass is this other stuff.
Since the earliest days of humanity, we have been obsessed with figuring out how things work. And we've come a long way and understand quite a bit of our world. But the vast majority of the inner workings of the universe remain unknown. Thanks for watching. Did you like this video? Then show your support by liking, subscribing, and ringing the bell to never miss videos like this.